Good evening, everyone. Glad to see that everybody is thoroughly digesting both dinner this evening as well as the topics of the day. But just as right now you are enjoying dessert, we have also chosen something this evening to be kind of a dessert topping for a lot of the discussions today. Maybe just as a kind of a way of settling into this. So you know, many of us grow through our careers, and we are very focused on our technical work. We all know that that's a lot of the reason that we got into academia and did research, is that we wanted to really focus strongly on technical work. And for us, we adopted a fundamental principle of computer science about the government, which is it's a black box where you make certain function calls and you get certain things back. So you make a function call, which is you send in a proposal to some agency, and you hope that the return is not a fail return, and you actually get something coming back out of it. But as I have gotten more and more involved in particularly the CCC, really as my first entree into understanding more how the science policy community works, I've come to realize the different layers and mechanisms within science policy that really I think are not visible to the average person. But you know, as you start to open up the API and you start to see how it's constructed, you start to see deeper and deeper layers where you can make deeper and deeper function calls, and you can get all sorts of interesting behaviors out of it if you actually know how to access those layers. Well, to get that sort of an understanding, you obviously need a guide. And I have to say that since I joined the CCC, our speaker this evening, Susan Graham, really has been my guide into understanding how these sorts of mechanisms work and you know, really what it is to participate in science policy discussions at the highest possible level. And I think as you'll see as I talk a little bit about her background, she's really the perfect person to talk a little bit about what it's like to start to move your career in the direction of understanding really the mechanics of government and science policy. So just to give you a little bit of background on Susan. So Susan's the Pei-Hung Chen Distinguished Professor of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science Emerita at the UC Berkeley. Her research background is generally in the area of programming language implementation, software tools, software development environments, and high-performance computing. Just as one example, which I told her today, I suddenly realized that she had a very early impact in my life. She was a participant in the Berkeley Unix project, where she and her students built the Berkeley Unix Pascal system and the widely used program profiling tool GPROF. So when I was a grad student, I was writing code, and I do not think I could have finished my PhD without GPROF. So I already realized that she had a strong impact in my life. And in fact, GPROF has been widely recognized. Her paper on GPROF appeared in the list of the 50 most influential PLDI papers of all time as one of four papers of the 1982 year. So clearly, someone who's had lasting impact in the research field. Susan has a number of honors. I could go on for quite some time, but let me just quickly say she's a member of the National Academy for Engineering, a fellow of the Association for Computing Machinery, of the American Association for Advancement of Science, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and the IEEE. She was the founding editor-in-chief of the ACM Transactions on Programming Languages and Systems. She's won a number of awards, the IEEE von Neumann Medal, the Berkeley Citation, the ACM IEEE Ken Kennedy Award, and the CRA Distinguished Service Award among them. She has served, and this really gets, I think, to what she will be able to speak to this evening. She served on numerous advisory committees. So she was on the President's Information Technology and Advisory Committee, sometimes called PTAC, some years back. She was the chief computer scientist for the NSF-sponsored National Partnership for Advanced Computational Infrastructure from 1997 to 2005. She served as vice chair and chair of the Computing Community Consortium, really since its inception, first as vice chair and then chair. And then most recently, she was named as a member of the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology, otherwise known as PCAST, and in that role has a direct advising relationship to the President. So Susan, really through her career, has, I think, exemplified both research excellence, but also service to the community at all levels, and I'm very much looking forward to hearing her remarks tonight. So without further ado, my great friend and colleague, Susan Graham.
Thank you, Greg, and thank you, everybody, for allowing me to speak with you. I'm just thrilled to be here because I have so many friends and colleagues that I've known over the years, and many new people that I met when I looked at your posters. So my role is to tie computing technology to policy. That's what I want to do for you. And I'm going to do that through my PCAST experience. But before I do that, I want to remind you of how much computing changes and how quickly it changes. Just with two examples. When I first used a computer was a big machine that sat in a machine room, and I would venture to say most of the public just didn't know it was even there. It was a small community of people that actually had that opportunity. We then had one large paradigm shift with the introduction of the personal computer. For which our speaker tomorrow morning, Butler Lampson, was very instrumentally involved. And all of a sudden, we had computing for the people. And we had a whole new set of applications. But computers were still devices that sat in a room or sat on your desk or supposedly sat on your lap. Now we're in another paradigm shift, in which we have mobile devices, we have sensor networks, we have computers all around us. Everybody engages with computers, and it's mostly implicit. Mostly people don't think about the fact that they're using computers. They're getting services that are computing enabled. Okay, so the challenge for policy is, how do you get policy to keep up with that kind of change in technology? And it's true for other technology areas, but it's particularly true for computing technology. So that brings me to PCAST. I was lucky to be invited to join PCAST in the fall of 2013. When Ann asked me if I was going to have any slides, I said, well, I could show you a picture of me sitting next to the President, which I did. But you know what the President looks like, and now you know what I look like, so I didn't need the slide. But if you're a student of recent history, you'll remember that shortly after that, the Snowden revelations came out. Okay, and on January 17th of 2014, the President made a speech in which he said, we need to address the issues of privacy. This was after people in our community had been saying to the government repeatedly, privacy is important, you need to mount a research program in privacy, and it wasn't really happening. But all of a sudden, it was important, and the President made the speech, and he said, I'm going to have my people at the White House, this is the Office of Science and Technology Policy, develop some policies around privacy, and I'm going to ask PCAST to advise us, advise the White House, about the technology aspects of privacy, particularly as it relates to what was then called big data. And I want your report in 90 days. And since there were two of us on PCAST, me, the newbie, and Bill Press, who was a little more experienced, and we were from academia, not from industry, we were asked to chair this study. Mostly what PCAST does is it provides its advice in the form of reports, and then we actually do get to discuss our recommendations with the president. And at that time, I knew very little about privacy. I knew what people in our field know if that's not the field they work in. I now know a whole lot about privacy. So we did this study, and we were told, you're not supposed to make policy recommendations. It's the White House policy group that's supposed to make the policy recommendations. What you need to do is tell us how big data and technology plays into policy. And of course, we did make recommendations about how they should formulate that policy. And there are really two takeaway lessons that we told them. One is that almost all personal information is now in digital form. As Miguel said earlier today, consumers strip naked. In other words, we voluntarily give up a lot of personal information in return for services or various kinds of goodies, like airline points or something like that. And we give that away. There are other sources of information that are public in the interests of transparency. And then there's information that's collected that we individually didn't personally volunteer. Okay. And we have incredible ability now to combine information from different sources and to analyze that information in pretty sophisticated ways. And you're going to hear all about that in the panel tomorrow, or not all about it, but a lot about it. So trying to protect privacy by trying to control collection is a losing game, okay? Because you have no control over the collection. And it's happening for a lot of beneficial reasons as well as the possibly harmful ones. So what you, the policy people, need to focus on is how that information gets used. What you do with the information is where the harm comes in, not how you gather it. Because if it sits there, if it's what my database friends called write once, read never, then who cares? So that was one piece of advice we gave them. The other piece of advice was that it's a mistake most of the time to build mechanism into policy, into law, because the mechanisms change. What you want is to build in the goal, the purpose, the desired outcome. One example for those of you who do some work in the medical field is HIPAA. HIPAA is a regulation that was intended to protect the privacy of electronic health records, which were something the government worked really hard to try to enable. There's nothing in there about Fitbits. There's nothing in there about the monitoring that's on your smartphone because it wasn't anticipated. And so the regulations for that and also other reasons have become much less effective because the particular technology was hardwired to the regulation. And that's a, I would argue, mistake that happens over and over again. So that's the first example. That was the first project I worked on starting a month after I joined the committee. The way the committee works is that some projects are requested by the president, and some are generated by PCAST ourselves, and some are requested by other groups. And when we mount a study, prepare a report, anyone on PCAST can work on any one of the reports, although there's a moral obligation to work on the reports that match your expertise. And we bring in a lot of other people for the community. So I'm going to tell you about three other projects that I've worked on in the year and a half since I've been there, and for each one, try to draw a policy lesson from our activity. And it's actually going to be much easier because of today's session, because two of those projects were pretty well discussed. So So the first one was a study on technology for cities. And that was in concert with the fact that the White House was interested in smart cities and so on. And one of the policy challenges there is that most of what's done for cities is done by the cities, by the states. And so you have to figure out, well, what is the federal role in helping out the cities? Now, it turns out to be really important because over 80% of our population in the US lives in metropolitan areas. Over 90% of the GDP is generated in those metropolitan areas. And the trend in the US and in other countries is that that's going to increase. So more and more of the population is going to live in cities. Millennials are flocking to cities, whereas in the 90s, people were fleeing from cities. So cities are going to be really important. And I thought, well, we're going to talk about transportation, we're going to talk about smart buildings. In fact, the study ended up being a lot broader than that. Charlie Catlett, who you heard this morning, was a key person in this study. And it ended up being a lot about data. And if you think about what the panelists talked about today, a lot of it was about data. And what we discovered is the big cities are doing really interesting things. LA has a working relationship with the real-time navigation apps such as Waze, in which they provide those apps with information about road closures and local flooding and things like that. In exchange, the navigation apps help them with deploying police and fire and sanitation and all of their city services. Really, really pretty interesting stuff. Chicago, as you heard, has this whole environmental sensing set of applications which have all kinds of uses for the city of Chicago. New York has an inventory of its more than a million buildings to assess their fire vulnerability, and then they can predict where fires might break out. They're also doing some predictive policing, which some people are a little concerned about, but the idea is that based on previous patterns of crime, you can deploy your police where there might be future incidents of crime. But each one of these cities is rolling its own. Each one is developing its own really interesting solutions to particular problems. And what you'd like, and what our one of our major computing recommendations was, you really need integration, you really need interoperability. Where have we heard this before, right? This is bread and butter for this community. So the idea, what we recommended that the federal government help to create something we called a city web, in which there would be a shared platform, there would be sharing of best practices, there would be sharing of software, and not only would that prevent reinventing the wheel for every city, that would mean that cities with fewer resources could actually get some of this technology without having to develop it. And then there's the whole payment model, but that's down the road. But that was something that was, by the time we were done, was obvious to our study group and an aha moment for a lot of these people that work in cities. So that was a case in which having that policy in place can really accelerate new things that are happening in the country. Okay, so there are new activities, there's new policy, there's sharing, it reduces costs, it brings more attention, and that'll help move things forward. And this will also help the agencies. Transportation has projects they have to do with transportation. HUD has projects that have to do with housing. Department of Energy has projects that have to do with energy. The EPA has projects that have to do with air quality. NIST has projects, and I'm probably leaving some of them out. And you'd like to be able to integrate that data so that you can use multiple kinds of data to address problems in a richer way. And that's starting to happen. So that was really satisfying. Meanwhile, let me just give you one example of policy because I found it so amazing. There was a study of transportation in Los Angeles that was done in 2005, so that's 11 years ago. And what they found was that Los Angeles County had 18.6 million parking spaces that were using 14% of the land in Los Angeles County. In the central business district of LA, 81% of the space, if you also consider vertical space, is used for parking. Okay? 30% of the traffic is people looking for parking. Okay? So, facilitated by this community, we're developing autonomous vehicles, and we've enabled the sharing economy with the Uber-like sharing of surface vehicles. So, in fact, as we increase the length of energy that you can store, there's no reason that you should ever have to park a car in the central city. Okay, even if you own the car drops you off and it autonomously goes and parks at the extremities. Okay, and there are people who believe that that's happening. Now, if that's really going to happen in 10 years, okay, what should you invest now when you build new buildings? Do you build parking facilities or do you use that to increase available housing? I was at an electric vehicle workshop last week, and they were talking about the fact that we're going to transition to electric power instead of fossil fuel, instead of gasoline. We need charging stations. Every new building should build a charging station. Well, if we're not going to charge things in the central city, do we want to invest all that money in infrastructure now that we won't need later? And I don't have an answer except to say these are policy decisions that cost real money that can't be addressed unless people understand what's coming, understand the computing-enabled new technology, and have the tools to make those decisions and the trade-offs between getting more people to use shared vehicles now and waiting until you don't need the charging stations at all. So let me turn to the next project, and that was this report on aging. And Beth Minat was very involved in that. Margaret was involved in that, the panel that you heard earlier. And I'm not going to talk about the aging report because that was done so well by the panel, but I am going to talk about the topic that Beth mentioned at the beginning, and that's hearing. We did a separate report on hearing because we thought we could do it more quickly. This was a project the president had requested. We would have something to give him sooner. And I naively thought, this is low-hanging fruit. Okay? The reason it's low-hanging fruit is that it turns out that, number one, virtually everybody loses some hearing as they age. So 25% of people in their 60s have some hearing loss. Half of the people in their 70s have some hearing loss. Roughly 80% of people 80 or older have hearing loss. Okay, and it's just nature. This isn't disease. This isn't anything unusual. These little hairs deteriorate. Okay, so it's what we call normal aging, which is different from disease-related or trauma-related loss of hearing. Hearing aids in this country right now cost over $3,000 each. You have to have a medical exam in order to get a hearing aid. hearing aids are not covered by Medicare, so it's an out-of-pocket expense. And there was one other. And they're regulated by the FDA as medical devices. Okay, so lots and lots of barriers to getting hearing aids. And the market is controlled by six companies. So something like 95% of all hearing aids are sold by these six companies. On the other hand, we have a very advanced consumer electronics industry. Consumer electronics builds a lot of devices that have to do with audio. People are totally accustomed to sticking things in their ears. You walk around and you see, you know, all the time. And why can't we use, and they're much more advanced. Hearing aids changed from audio to digital, and then the marketplace essentially stopped innovating because there's no way for the innovators to get into the market. That's why it seemed like low-hanging fruit. So the reason things are that way is that there are policies regulating hearing aids that are 40 years old. They come from the time of analog devices. They come from a time when the government was afraid that older people would be taken advantage of if some door-to-door salesperson was trying to sell them hearing aids. And there's now a lot of vested interest, and nobody wants to change. And so we said there ought to be a class of hearing aids for what we call normal aging that in which these regulations don't apply. They can be sold without a medical exam, they can be sold over the counter. You have to be able to get a prescription and evaluation of your hearing that you can take to a different vendor, you can shop around, and then there'll be competition, and then there'll be a marketplace that drives down the price, and then Medicare could probably afford to provide them. And we interviewed a lot of people, and we tended to do that with teleconferences. And one of the interviews we had with somebody who had one of these vested interests, and he said, and we were sort of trying out some of our recommendations before we officially made them, and he said, the trouble with you is that you have the ear of the president. And so if you make this recommendation, it might actually happen. So we issued this report, and we've gotten both really positive and really flaming criticism. But I think it's probably going to happen. And so that was a triumph. But that, in that case, the policy issue was that there were lots of people that knew that this was an out-of-date policy, and there seemed to be no way to move the needle. And now I think we finally broke through. So that was the second experience. I'm currently working on a project on pattern-based forensics. Okay, right? Computer scientist working on pattern-based forensics. And part of the reason I started doing that was because I was so offended by forensic science and the extent to which it's not a science. So, and the fact that it's got serious consequences for people. I happened to be at a dinner with Brian Stevenson, who has a project called the Equal Justice Project at NYU. There are people who go to prison for life on the basis of what turns out to be faulty. And so pattern-based forensics is fingerprint matching and footprint matching and bite mark analysis and firearm analysis, and it's a craft, okay? You become an expert by having some training and having done it a lot of times. That makes you an expert, and you go into court, and you're an expert witness, and both the defense and the prosecution have an interest in, you know, making their case. The judge is there as the gatekeeper for whether evidence is allowable or not. And the judge is not a scientist or an engineer almost all the time, Okay, so they're really hard-pressed to decide the validity of something like this. Well, we've been doing pattern matching since the early years of computing. Carla talked about pattern matching in the first talk of this session. We find patterns in all kinds of natural and artificial phenomena, and we're pretty good at it. So my challenge to you is, this is an ongoing study. I don't know what the recommendations are going to be. I can tell you all this because this isn't the first study that of forensics that's been done. But think about what we would have to do to have a science-based, more objective way to decide, for example, whether a partial print belongs to. If you have 10 really good images, as you have when you give your fingerprints for a security clearance or something like that, then we actually can do machine-based pattern matching. But if you have some partial prints or you have some partial striations from bullets, how would you do it? One of the first things you do is you probably get a big corpus of examples of instances, and you'd bring to bear a lot of our analysis technology. And what one would hope this community could do is not only determine the likelihood of a match, but determine the likelihood that you don't have a match, which is the key issue if you want to determine that somebody's innocent. So let me throw that out as a challenge to this community. This is technology that doesn't exist right now, and that mostly people outside of forensic science have not paid any attention to. So here, let me follow that on. In fact, we're clearly moving into the age of pattern matching that essentially depends on digital information. So we have all these cameras, as somebody described. I know, it was a poster session, that's right. We have all these cameras. They're there, a lot of them are there for surveillance, not only to deter crime, but to record crime, okay? And so now the pattern is to figure out who the shadowy figure is in the video that you can associate with a particular crime. And of course, the subjective way to do that is to say, Joe is sitting here, is that Joe in the video? The more objective way is to say, there's a person in the video, how can you narrow down who that person is? Okay, but that's coming. And we have the opportunity to create more of an objective way of doing that kind of person recognition before it becomes a craft. There are also obviously digital fingerprinting coming, in which you try to identify someone from his or her online behavior. Again, one can envision a science-based way of doing that. One can also envision ways that it's going to be totally abused. So I throw that out to you as a challenge for our community that I think has enormous societal importance, and in which regulation, policy, is probably not the solution, unless you can say that here are some good methods, and so you can use those methods, and they're better than this craft. But until you do that, you can't just have a law that says you can't bring this into court, because it's up to the judge whether you can bring it into court or not. So and now I have a note to myself which says, recall what Carter said, and I can't remember why I wrote that down. So Carter, if you're still here, maybe you'll tell me. So, but here's the bottom line. Computing is ubiquitous. It's all around us. It's used by everybody for everything. Policy has to be resilient in the face of change, because things change and the policy sits there. We are the experts in computing technology. So we have an obligation to work with policymakers, to teach policymakers, to insert ourselves into that community, and at the education level, at the research level, and also at the government service level, so that as we advance our technology, society gets it right. So that's my message. And I'm happy to take questions.
I see questions coming up already.
You call.
Since you have the ear of the president.
Stand up.
Occasionally I have the ear of the president.
You know what they think, right? What do you think they think about the sorry state of the state universities? What is anybody worried about the longer term trend of research universities?
So the American Academy of Arts and Sciences has done a series of, I think it's 5 reports about state universities that are available online. And I think that's a place to start. I don't know, that's not a conversation that we have had, so I know what I read in the newspaper.
Mark?
So we have a parochial computer science question now that you deal with the broader world. So through most of our career, computer scientists have been regarded very positively. Mm-hmm. Now there's some trends of like, we're taking all the money and we're putting people out of work. Is this something we should worry about?
Where's Seda? Seda and I were having a conversation about that earlier today. And what somebody said earlier, we have a responsibility. I'm not sure the accusation is totally, I mean, it's not totally our fault, but as citizens and as members of the community, we have some responsibility to share our expertise and to solve problems of all kinds.
The White House, I saw an announcement just last week, is organizing a series of workshops now on the impact of artificial intelligence.
So the artificial intelligence question is not just labor, it's also are those, there are security issues about whether the use of artificial intelligence creates vulnerabilities, and whether there are threats to our society. You could manipulate voting, you could do all kinds of evil things. Labor is part of it, but that, as I understand it, is not why the conversation started.
So you said something about forensic science, and I was curious whether you have any ideas about policy relating to any kind of statistical significance, because having served on a jury, reasonable doubt is ill-defined.
Right.
And especially if you're going to be getting input from algorithms that are giving some probabilities conditioned on various events, I think it's really important that we figure out what statistically significant data and what sorts of computations jurors and judges are allowed and expected to do.
So that's part of what I was getting at with likelihood. It's part of our obligation is to help to teach lawyers and judges, and particularly judges, how to distinguish bad information from good information. In other words, because they depend on expert witnesses, and the question is this a credible witness? Okay? I'm giving you a lot of my opinions because, as I said, we don't have the report and the recommendations, and so I feel free to look at it from. So it's there again. It's hard to have policy because it's shifting sand, right? Because the methods keep changing and the analysis keeps getting better.
Yep. So there have been different PCAST-like entities over many decades of different administrations. I'm curious what your predictions might be on 2017. You don't have to name your favorite political candidates.
The president has a science advisor. The current science advisor is John Holdren, who's fantastic. And he chairs OSTP, which is an internal government group at the White House, and PCAST, which is an external, it's a group of 20 people who don't work for the government. And that structure on paper has existed for a long time. One of the things that I worked on that I didn't mention was, you heard earlier about the NITRD program, NITRD, and you're gonna hear from Keith tomorrow. There's legislation, that goes back to 1991, and the legislation says that program, which is an interagency coordination program, is supposed to be reviewed every 2 years. So that was 25 years ago when that legislation was passed. And I just co-chaired the most recent review with Greg, and one of the people on our committee said we should really say that it's the nth review, whatever n is. And I went back and I looked, and there have been 5 reviews. It's supposed to be reviewed every 2 years. It's been 25 years. You do the math. And that's because, so, and I've actually done 4 of them, which, so there was one, there was one in the mid-90s in the Clinton administration. There was one during the 8 years of the Bush administration, and which is the one I didn't do. And there have been 3 in the Obama administration. Ed Lisowska chaired a major study in 2010. Peter Lee and I did an update study at the end of 2012, and then we just did this one. So it really depends on the president and whether the president thinks science is important and who the president chooses to surround herself with to whether it's taken seriously or not.
I'm curious if you revisit some of the policies from the previous PCAST or recommendations. You mentioned that there are some policies that are 20, 30 years old, and the computing is just moving so fast. Mm-hmm. Does, do you have the mandate to basically go back to what happened in the 90s? Like the HIPAA is a perfect example that now with all the mobile devices, with the implants, security, privacy, is there an attempt to come back and make new recommendations?
There isn't so much an attempt to go back as when an issue comes up and there's a study, sometimes that's part of how you consider what to do next. I mean, we're always looking to what should happen rather than what did happen. There are, of course, continuing studies of cybersecurity. I didn't tell you about all the reports or even all the reports I've been involved in, just the ones that made my points. But cybersecurity is a continuing theme. Biothreats are a continuing theme. Climate is a continuing theme. And so, yeah, you go back and you look at the previous recommendations that didn't happen.
Yeah, there.
Do you see opportunities or future chances to review intellectual property and specifically patent law is, and whether or not it's serving the community and the country well?
So my guess is that that's a different advisory. There are a bunch of different advisory committees, and that probably wouldn't come to us. But if somebody could, yeah, push a little, it might be nice.
Yeah, back there.
So you were talking about science and technology changing, but you also have the second part, the policy makers changing. Moore's law changes like once 2 years, Congress changes once 2 years, president changes 4 years. Which is a bigger challenge as someone who advises on policy? Is it the science change that's not accounted in policies, or the policy makers changing that we can't account?
So it's both. I mean, we were told, I can't remember what the issue was, but we were told, I think it had to do with hearing, that the person who was previously head of that office in the FDA was very opposed to change, and now there's somebody who who gets it a little bit more, and this might be an opportune time to push a little bit for change. Chuck can probably talk to that, having been in the government. But and the policy, I mean, the policy in Congress at the moment, we're advising the White House and the president, but ultimately, a lot of these policies have to be enacted by Congress. And I don't think I have to tell you how difficult that climate is right now.
What do we do as a science community to help you?
We continue to push for the recommendations we think are important for the country. One of the things that happens is people do pick up old reports that you think have had no impact, and all of a sudden they're important for a new person in a policy position, and then they get a lot of attention. Chuck.
So you mentioned that PCAST can, on occasion, bubble up its own ideas for studies.
Mm-hmm.
Has that happened recently? Can you give
an
example?
That's where the city study came
from.
Yeah.
Do they need to be approved at some higher level, or can you on your own recognizance get a study started?
Well, since the chair is the president's science advisor, I would assume that there's a process because, it is an investment of our time and the staff's time.
Any other questions? Great. Susan, thank you so much for your time, and thank you so much for all of your service to the community. It's really amazing that you have the time.
I've had a good time.